Oh snap, Blaze is going live.
Good day, good day, good day, good day, good day. Thank you for joining me. Just in case you're joining me for the very first time, I'm your host, the one they call Brian Glaze Gibbs. This is my ministry. This is my platform. What I do is I talk about the good, I talk about the bad, I talk about the ugly. And I do that, how do I share my life experience and those that I know experience to get people to listen to the words that come out of my mouth. That's why we got two ears, one mouth. Listen and take a hold, take heed to the lesson. Learn. Because once again, everybody do not have to be testimony. Today, what I'm going to talk about, I'm going to talk about this guy. His name is Tommy Mickens, a.k.a. Tommy Montana. And when you hear about that, you think of Scarface, the movie. But this is a real life guy. Google him. Google Tommy Mickens and see what you come up with. And to me, like right now, is guess what? I met Tommy years ago at MCC New York. You know, when we both was fighting the Fed case. And right now, very, very interesting character. If I must say myself, I call him like the Richie Rich of that comic book, Richie Rich, the poor little rich boy. Okay? And why? Because once again, Tommy was a hell of an individual, man. He was in his own little private world. So to me, what I'm gonna do is read something from the New York Post, okay, and what it's saying. A drug kingpin who controlled a multi-million dollar cocaine empire in Queens that was so lucrative, his lifestyle became the stuff a rap lyric and street legend is now in the midst of a senior moment. He eventually amassed fleets of 21 luxury cars, including a Rolls Royce equipped with a TV, a Ferrari, a Lamborghini, a $800,000 mansion in Dix Hill, Long Island, a 38-foot yacht paid for in cash, a helicopter, and a million-dollar smile showing off his diamond and emerald bonded to his teeth. His lifestyle was immortalized by the rapper 50 Cent in the song Ghetto Quran. Lord knows, Tommy had Lauriton soul, helicopter, Rolls Royce with Louis Vuitton interior, and might sound like I'm fantasizing, but son, I'm dead serious. Mickens soon owned a string of businesses along Merritt and Rockaway Boulevard and Hollis Avenue, all with the Montana brand. Montana Dry Cleaner, Montana Sporting Goods, Montana Grocery. Wow. He say he stopped hustling in 86, but the feds nabbed him in 1988. And in 1989, he was convicted of drug dealing, money laundering, and tax evasion. He was fined $1 million, had $2.5 million in assets seized, and was handed 35 years. Sit back and think about it, man. This kid, when you look at it, we're around the same age. And when you sit back and you think about it, what happened? The brother got caught up into, you heard of Lorenzo Fat Cat Nichols. You heard of Howard Pappy Mason. You heard of the Supreme Team, Bimmy, Black Just. You heard of so many others that was out there. Corleys, you heard about these guys. Brian Glaze Gibbs, you heard about these guys. But guess what? How many of you actually heard of Tommy Mickens, Tommy Montana? Right now is, like you say, Nas did a video, you know what I'm saying, with Tommy right there when he first came home. So he was who he say he was. Right now, he lived that life. But the difference with him, very little violence came behind his name. He operated in the same street, but he operated on a whole totally different level. You know, to me, he'd been hustling. From my understanding, since he was 16 years old, started out, you know what, got a crew. And what they was hustling, they was more or less like he's paying guys to deliver grocery. Okay? So he used to get the money and he used to split it with them. But then again, he starts seeing all the hustlers, the guys that was going to high school with him, what they was doing. They was doing better and they had way more stuff than him. So what he did is he got competitive. He got into the weed game. Okay? Went away when he was 17 because he started selling coke. So the different folks, everybody start from somewhere. Everybody. And what well, here it is, we all got a similar story. How we started, why we started. We started because we want to be fly. We see other people doing better than us. So do you think we go out there and get a job? Apply for an application? No. Tommy was a high school dropout. A high school dropout. But yet and still, regardless of what, look what he was able to accomplish. A mansion in Dix Hill, Long Island. Okay? Ferrari, Rolls Royce, helicopter. That's why I call him the poor little rich boy. You know what I'm saying? Richie Rich, man. Because once again, that's him. And you know what? I remember me and him being on MCC. And to me, cool dude. He was in his own little private world. Guess what? I'm me. You know, rough around the edge. I'm in my own private world. We was on the flip floor together. And an incident took place. And the incident that took place was Pappy got mad. Because Pappy like, yo, man, what this BS that Tommy talking about us? You know, how the hell he can even, you know, talk about us like that? I heard he talking greasy about us. I'm saying, huh? I said, bro, I don't know nothing about that, man. So, you know, long story short, you know what I did was, guess what? I went upstairs, I confronted Tommy, okay? And I told Tommy, look, what's all this stuff you talking about, you know, our group, our little organization? Talking about we this, we that, or what? He said, nah. He said, it didn't happen like that. I was speaking about one individual in particular. And that individual is such and such. I say, he was such and such. And he wasn't doing it like that. And he should have stuck to, you know, scalping ticket at Madison Square Garden opposed to trying to hustle. He said, that's what I say. And you know what? Even when he said it, the guy that he was speaking about was right there with us. And he didn't bite his tongue. He say what he mean. And you know what? Like I told you right now, Wiz, other than that, like I said, we used to go to court. And I'm talking about the federal COs. They used to be on Tommy. And we used to come back from court. Here it is. Everybody got waiting in the bullpen. They used to tell him, come on, Tommy. Tommy go like, yo, I want my man to come. Mind you, we didn't really have much of a relationship. High and by, nod head. When I got there, you know what I'm saying? When I got extradited, and I got extradited back to MCC from Talladega, Alabama, when I was on a run. And when I got there, you know what? I came in there with a link chain and a gold house medallion. So guess what? He had to get something better. When I got there with some new, you know what I'm saying, like the latest, you know what I'm saying, high top Nike forces. So guess what? Whatever somebody else had, if you have it, Tommy had to get more. He had to get something better. And look, like I told you, he's the type of brother. If he went to commissary, if he could have went to commissary first and bought everything in commissary, guess what? Tommy would have did it. You know, doing Valentine's Day. Everybody getting Valentine's Day cards. You know, your wife, your girl, they send you little Valentine's Day cards. Guess what, man? This cat got, I'm talking about right now, a big Valentine's Day card, like basically the size of the damn door. Come on, man. Because when Tommy did it, Tommy had to do it like Tommy. He was very, very, very arrogant. I remember, like I said, everybody busy. We on the phone. You know what I'm saying? Chilling. Talking to your wife, talking to your girl, letting them know everywhere, right? This brother, he out there talking on the phone. Boom. Magic Johnson. When Magic Johnson still played for the LA Lakers back then. So look, what I'm just trying to say, folks, listen. Here it is. He went away. And what I'm trying to say is, you know what? It's not what he went away from. It's like, you know, here it is. We all poison our community. We all commit a crime. Okay? But the difference is he went away. And look what he's doing now. Basically right now, he got the Tommy experience. He got the Tommy platform. He changed his whole life around. And what he did is he out there, you know what I'm saying, training. You know what I'm saying, taking care. You know what I'm saying, all of the elderlies. He taking care of them. He more or less like whipping them all back into shape. You know what I'm saying? Why? How did that all start? You know how that all started? It started when his mother, he lost his mother the same way I lost my mother to a massive stroke. And right now, Tommy Mickens, president / CEO of the Tommy Experience. Okay, we enrich the lives and quality of life of our senior community by being proactive, rather reactive, with an array of service centering on effective, non-strenuous physical activity, coupled with the most important ingredient of all, love. Our customized program maximize, you know what I'm saying, stimulate, you know what I'm saying, stimulation, improve natural range of motion, and rejuvenate the spirit of today's senior community. Specialty, yoga, boxing, nutritional plan, boot camp, aerobic, strength training, flexibility training, staff leadership, fitness development. This is what this brother came home and did. He got himself together. And once he did it all because of what? Because once again, when he went away, he learned. He learned everything that he was doing was wrong. He learned everything, what he was doing, picking up the brick, throwing at the prison wall for absolutely nothing. The same way he was able to go out there and, you know, say hustle and became one of the fancy, you know what I'm saying, drug lord on, you know what I'm saying, in what Queens? You know, like I said, you heard of Supreme Team, you heard of Fat Cat, you heard of Corleys, you heard of Howard Pappy Mason, you heard of Brian Glaze Gibbs. How many of y'all actually heard of Tommy Mickens? Whereas now what he's doing is he's giving back. You know what I'm saying? He's giving back to the elderly. You know what I'm saying? Teaching them how to live. Teaching them how to be healthy. Teaching them how to exercise. And these folks, they love him. Because right now, like they say, he got that million-dollar smile. But he got a million-dollar personality to go along with that. So it doesn't matter what you've been through. It's matter, like, it doesn't matter what he did in the past. It's what he's doing now. What he's doing now. So folks, those of you that's not familiar with Tommy Mickens, Tommy Montana, Google him. Right now is you Google him and read up on him. See what he's all about. Because once again, Tommy, if you listen to this, listen, here it is right now, we both change. We grow up. I don't know about you. I know probably right now you don't like to keep the hair on your face because you got that baby face. You see all this baby powder. Bingo. Like right now, I went from being what? A hustler. Being a killer. Destroying our community. Now, like I said, what I'm doing is, how do we save life? Let's join forces, man. How do we save life? I got doctors. I'm talking about prominent doctors. You know what I'm saying? Businessmen. And what we're doing is, we're trying to save lives. We're trying to save life, one life at a time. We're trying to get people to know what the Pranoxol. How do Pranoxol save life? It's a natural ingredient. How it can stop high blood pressure. Okay? Massive stroke. Okay? High cholesterol, high blood, high sugar, okay, high weight. How it'll give you a natural energy, you know what I'm saying, boost you, your immune system. Folks, listen, natural ingredient. Tommy, that's what I'm doing. I'm trying to get back. I was once the problem. You was once the problem. How do now we join forces? Like I tell people, you down with OPP? Yeah, you know me. Let's get down with BGG. Let's get down with the Tommy experience. Let's blend it together. Let's make it happen, man. Let's make it happen. Let's save people. Let's get back to the community by any means necessary. Yo, folks, listen. This is Brian Glaze Gibbs. This is my ministry. Listen, I am not your typical minister. But what I'm going to talk about, the good, the bad, and the ugly. But the end of it, change, folks. Change. What it took me to change? The death of my mother. Tommy, what it took Tommy to change? Like he say, he got into this. You know what I'm saying? Training the elderly because he lost his mother to a massive stroke. People, that's deep. So what I'm just trying to say right now is it's not how we start. Look at him. Here it is. Legit businessman. Law-abiding citizen. Look at me. A legit man. Law-abiding. Working man. Honest man. Law-abiding citizen. Productive. Now. So what we need to do, join forces and teach these kids, it's not too late. It's not how you start, how you finish. Don't even become a Tommy Mickens. Don't become a Supreme. Don't become a Prince. Don't become a Howard Pappy Mason. Don't become a Fat Cat. Don't become a Brian Glaze Gibbs. Folks, it's not too late. Take it from somebody that know. In order to change, change comes from within. But if you do it right the first time, you don't have to worry about it. Peace, love, and prosperity. One love.
Yo, Glaze, I just got to my favorite part of your book. This is Out of Prison as a New Person. So, page 308, May of 1998. That's actually when I had the pleasure of meeting you.
And, you know, I'm not in the best of shape. I was 500 pounds.
Wow.
Very, you know, my old BMI was over 65 or something like that. I had got diagnosed with venous reflux. I never heard of that. I was like, what is that? They were like, your veins, the valves are not closing, so the blood is collecting in your ankle area, in your right leg, and that's what's causing all the swelling and the pain. They put me on a lot of different medicines, and then he said, yo, you're going to have this operation on your leg to reverse your the vein flow. Almost like DVT or varicose veins or something, mm-hmm. You know, where they put a balloon in your ankle and let it come up your leg to close and cauterize that vein so your blood will go about another direction. Now, that's what you guys recommended. But then I started taking the Pranoxol, so After about 45 days of taking Panoxyl, I told him, I said, listen, can you guys do a second opinion on my leg because I'm feeling much better? The pain, will you guys operate or cut me? Just do a second ultrasound to make sure. So when they did the second ultrasound, they told me they changed the whole diagnosis and recommended I don't get the procedure. I've been losing weight. My doctors are happy. My blood pressure has gone down.
So you believe the supplement assisted you in your second opinion? It contributed to your not having to be cut necessarily.
I'm 100% sure.
Before, how long have you been using Panoxyl right now? Well, you're about 3 months into it. Supplement.
I lost over 40 pounds.
What?
It's all verified through the doctor in the hospital. They did help me in the bedroom a little bit. I'll give it that. But not what I'm looking for. I could hit a home run, but just the feeling of I don't have that vim and vigor that I used to have when I was younger.